You're watching Basement Sublet of Horror. Woo!
I'm Richard Wayne, and welcome to a special edition of Channel News. Tonight, we're taking a look at horror hosts and horror host shows. Horror host shows from Kansas City, from Lawrence, and from Wichita, Kansas. From Kansas City, we have an interview with Crematia Mortem, Kansas City's own horror host from The Creature Feature. From Wichita, we're going to take a look at The Host and Rodney, Wichita's horror host show, which ran from the 50s clear up to the 90s, featuring Tom Leahy. And we'll also have the behind-the-scenes making of The Basement Sublet of Horror, a feature called The Film Butcher. We take you now to Gunther Dedman. Gunther.
Oh, hello, my friends, and welcome to The Basement Sublet of Horror. I'm your host, Gunther Dedman, returning again, but tonight, a bit of a different night. We're going to show the behind-the-scenes making of The Basement Sublet of Horror. That's right, you get to see how all this crap is put together. Yes, it's called The Film Butcher, which I guess is about the film editor or something like that. And anyway, it's full of interviews and all kinds of behind-the-scenes stuff, so go, you will go and enjoy.
When Joel was little, not too little, we got an 8mm camera. Joel was always fascinated with that thing. And then we got an 8mm projector. And then he took off like a steam engine.
I started showing films in my garage when I was a kid. I turned my parents' basement into a movie theater.
And I made popcorn. And Joel went to the library and rented these films and set it all up in the garage, and we put sheets over the junk, fixed it all up like a movie theater.
I would hand draw flyers. There's no way to print them, so I would redraw them over and over again and hand those out to everyone in the neighborhood.
And I think it was quite a lot of fun. Kids sat there spellbound because this was before everybody had a television. So it was kind of fun to go over to the neighbors and watch movies.
Then when I moved to Lawrence, I had already collected a lot of films in Wichita when I came up here, because that was actually the tail end of when everybody was throwing them away. So I wanted to do a drive-in theme party because I'd worked a lot of drive-ins. I managed a drive-in in Emporia, and I kind of wanted to bring back a drive-in. A friend of ours had a huge backyard in Vinland. So he said, come on out here and we'll do it out here. So we did a whole series of the Escape drive-ins.
I'd heard about them. They were legendary, where out in the country, Joel would set up a big screen and do pretty much what you're doing with Basement Sublet of Horror, I think, with intersplicing of old archived footage in a comic way. And I'd never seen that. I'd known people who had gone to your shows or had seen your shows in Wichita, heard over and over how good you were at it and how entertaining they were. So I was pleased that was part of the Basement Sublet of Horror as well, as opposed to just the typical horror host.
Shows got out of hand. I mean, we'd have 200 to 300 people showing up. And it was really just myself and my wife and a couple other people doing all the work, and it just was too much for everybody to deal with. So I looked for another way to show films, and the Free State Brewery had just opened their beer garden, which was supposed to be a third movie theater for Liberty Hall. So it had the projection booth and everything, but it was just an empty shell. So I changed the name to the Empty Pockets Budget Film Fest as the indoor version of the movie show, and Empty Pockets ran at the Free State Brewery for 3 years. The Wichita Center for the Arts picked it up and as a summer replacement show, and it just wound up staying on and playing for 6 years down there. And the indoor version adopted a lot of the Escape drive-in elements, live music, prize drawing, along with a few new ones of interactive games. The trouble with that show was I did it too long, too many shows, and really just got burned out on it. I'd have to drive down to Wichita and load in the gear, and essentially I had some help, but it was essentially just me doing this whole thing again. And
our grand prize, the big can of pork and beans.
The next logical step was a TV show. In the genre of horror hosts, there are just a few characters that are worked with. So it's kind of, I just kind of see it as a form of theater in a way that has the archetype character that you play. There's the ghoul, there's the mad scientist, and I don't know, is there a third one? Usually they're ghouls and mad scientists. I went with the ghoul because that was what the host was. The host in Rodney, the host was actually Tom Leahy. He played the host and also played a science fiction host, a cartoon host in the afternoons called Major Astro. And Major Astro was on forever, and I would watch Major Astro, but I'd also watch the host and Rodney. So in the afternoons I had Major Astro, and late at night we had the host and Rodney. And it just was a really great thing because Tom's is really, you know, energetic and flamboyant and really goes over the top with the whole deal. And so he was always entertaining as the host. Kind of playing homage to the host and Rodney, but I'm also kind of doing a parody of the host and Rodney. I love the show. I've always loved the show, but just like I mess with the films, I have to mess with the format. The name Gunther Dedman came from a dream I had probably, I think, about 1983. The first appearance of Gunther Dedman is in a book of short stories that I wrote. But in the dream, I was watching a TV show, and it was called Gunther Dedman's Floating Spaceship. And from that point on, I just stuck in the back of my mind that I wanted to do a TV show with at least one of the characters being Gunther Dedman. In the 60s, Dick Smith, the famous makeup artist, put a magazine together for kids, The Famous Monsters of Filmland Makeup Handbook, and it showed you how to do a whole range of makeups from just ordinary household stuff. So Gunther Dedman is a takeoff on the ghoul, so the makeup is pretty much traditional ghoul makeup. I just sat down, made it up on the first show, and I put on heavier eyebrows. That just comes from Groucho Marx, because that's one of the things I read about him, is why he had those big eyebrows. It made his face more expressive. You know, big eyebrows, you can raise and lower them. And I'm also trying with the makeup, I didn't want to really be a celebrity, so what I'm doing is I tried to create a character that doesn't look like me, so that when I go out, I don't really want to be stopped as Gunther Dedman. I don't want people coming up to me.
Hello, my friends.
The worse my hair was in real life, the better it looked on the show, you know, so the more straggly it was, the better. So the very, very first show, I watched that again, and it's awfully short. I mean, I thought it was long at the time, but it looked much better towards the end of the season when it's really, really straggly. And Gunther Dedman's voice was, you know, just supposed to be this old man voice. And I tried it on camera and it just didn't work. And I know Gunther's a German name, so several people have said, why doesn't he have a German accent? Well, it just didn't make sense, and I felt silly doing a German accent. So I wasn't really trying to do an English accent. That's just what came out. That's the voice that I tried several voices on camera, and that's the first one that I felt comfortable using.
Action.
Hello, my friends, and tonight...
I wanted to have an elaborate opening title sequence, but once you get into digital compositing and putting things together, it really just takes a huge amount of time to process that video. So the opening of the show is actually a parody of the Horror Host show from Wichita, the host and Rodney. One of the later versions of the show, there was this old haunted house on the hilltop, and the camera would pull in slowly, and there'd be a light on in the window, like a dungeon window, and the camera would go to that window, and then it would crossfade to the set, which is the set of a dungeon. So since I grew up in ranch-style homes, and I now live in a ranch-style home, it struck me as funny to have the whole show take place in a ranch home. You know, just, I like the humor of that. And it's the same thing where the camera zooms in to a basement window, and it's the same idea. The opening title music is nothing high tech, you know, just a collected feel from a lot of different films. So the Don Knotts films and the Addams Family, all of that's all kind of mixed together, not really consciously. I just took it all in and made my own version of that because I wanted to have the same feel as a 60s or 70s horror TV show. I decided there's one thing lacking from the opening music, and that was a theremin, and didn't have access to a theremin. So that's where David Bagsby's credit comes in as keyboard consultant, is that he said, well, why don't you just use an analog synthesizer? Dragged out one of my old analog synths, and just, you know, a couple minutes I had a theremin and just played the whole, you know, theremin bit separate from the soundtrack and then just merged them together in the video.
Dang, cameraman. Never here when you need them. Good evening. I am your host, Gunther Dead.
It takes a lot of people to do a TV show, so what I try to do is sit down and find the way to make a show with absolutely nothing. No money, no help or anything. Mainly because I wasn't sure it would work. So the first six shows, I shot them all myself. I would set up the camera. The camera has a little monitor. I'd turn the monitor around so I could see it, and I would actually be running everything, running the audio and all that. So if you see the first episode, you'll actually see me wearing headphones, which is a glitch, a flaw, because I was supposed to take them off. So, you know, when you see me with headphones on in the early shows, that's because I just would space out and leave them on. But it really didn't matter anyway, because I don't know if people even noticed or even cared that. So I just left all the flaws in. There aren't any scripts for the show. Somebody asked me, like, you know, who writes the scripts, and there are no scripts. All I do is I make a list of the topics that the film was talking about when a break occurs, and then I just make up something on the spot, and it's more of a check sheet for me to make sure I get enough shots for the show. David Nicol, who's a neighbor of mine, volunteered to run the camera, and that made a big difference because I really had a tough time shooting the host segments, and it turned out the reason why is that with David Nicol there, I had immediate feedback. I would know if it was funny, something was funny or not. I could try a bit again, and I don't know, was that any good?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
You have a general idea of what you want to do for each segment. At the same time, it's pretty much just turning the camera on and seeing what you get. And that's the beauty of it. It's just been a learning experience for me, for the most part, and fun.
The editing style of the show is actually a style I came up with when I was doing the Escape Drive-In. I bought these bad horror films, but the trouble with a bad horror film is that very few people can sit through the whole thing or want to sit through the whole thing. So what I started doing was condensing them down to a half an hour and then intercutting them with other just unrelated material. These cutaways serve two purposes. One is for humor, the other is to distract people from the gaping plot holes that I've created by cutting the film down to nothing. That style is kind of adopted and been expanded on with the Basement Sublet. The main difference is being with digital editing, now I can do a lot of effects, I can clean it up. You don't hear all the tape splices that used to be in the Escape Drive-In films, and it's just a little bit slicker.
If he's wearing the wrong type of clothing, this would be a violation of the mores of his culture. Not only would he shock other members of his society and cause great disturbance, but his society might also take official action to stop him from this violation of its mores.
For an hour is actually because most of the empty pockets in Escape films were on 50-minute reels, so I'm still working with that 50-minute format. A normal hour of television is only 40 minutes, 35 minutes, with the rest of it all commercials. So there are no commercial breaks, so I needed an excuse to break away for the host to come back in. So actually, the public access breaks are actually my own separate little art project to add in photographs that are a bit askew or off-key. So they're civic shots of the city buildings, you know, but then there are also other things like that they would never show, like, you know, street construction, you know, and that's just stuff that I enjoy taking pictures of. The other thing I wanted to have in the show were more characters, you know, protagonists, you know, to Gunther Dedman, something that would irritate him or drive him crazy. Gunther Dedman is this guy sitting in the basement, you know, doing these shows, broadcasting them on his own. So I really wanted to have a neighbor come in, and the neighbor would just come in, it would just be an ordinary person, and he would shatter this reality, because you'd have this guy with all this makeup on and this guy, you know, everyday guy sitting next to him going like, hey, what are you doing? During one shoot, David Bagsby called me and he was dropping by some music discs or something, and when he got there, it just occurred to me that I'd wanted to do the neighbor, and here's this guy, and it's like, just pulled David down to the basement and said, do you want to be on the show? The neighbor morphs into an evil clone of Gunther Dedman called Renfield Chromosome. David made a parody of Gunther Dedman, and I don't know, I thought it was pretty funny, so that parody but wound up being written into a later show. I introduced a landlord. Just the landlord was always, you know, pounding on the floor from above, complaining about the noise that Gunther was making. And later on, I wanted to bring the landlord in. During the shoot of the neighbor, I brought up that David should just be the landlord. I was lucky enough to have some great publicity for the show. Ann Tangman, who is a writer for the Laurentian, Ann called me one day and said, well, it's going to be on the cover of the Laurentian. Through that, the Journal World did an article on the show. The interesting thing about that is all the photos in those articles, both articles, I shot all the photos for that, so that was kind of fun to be an amateur photographer and, you know, sneak some more of my work into the media. But a weird thing happened from the Journal World article. A scout for HGTV's show Offbeat America was scanning the internet for unusual dwellings or unusual houses or whatever, and she found the photo of me as Gunther Dedman in this apartment. and they thought it was real. So they called me up and they asked, actually the phone rang and this woman said, is Gunther there? And I said, I thought someone was messing with me. And I said, yes, this is Gunther. And she said, Gunther, we'd like to talk to you about being on HGV's show. And I was like, what? So I let her go on for a while because I thought it was a put on and it wasn't. They were actually talking to me about being on the show. And I said, do you realize this is fiction, right? This doesn't exist. There isn't an apartment. It's just part of my basement. There's a long pause. And she's like, oh, it actually made it to the meeting where they decide what's going to be on the show. But I guess compared to the other things they had, this wasn't interesting enough. So I got a rejection phone message.
Hi, Joel. He just wanted to let you know that at this time, your home was not selected to be on the program.
I think the charm in Gunther is that he's, for the most part, unscripted, very spontaneous. You never quite know what he's gonna do, which is part of the fun.
I'm much more comfortable as Gunther Dedman in front of the camera. Much more comfortable, because that's a character I can step into, and it's not me, and it's much easier to do.
Good night, my friends.
At this point, we will return to the basement sublet of horror.
And now, our interview with Crematia Mortem. Crematia Mortem was the host of Kansas City's horror host show, Creature Feature, from 1981 to 1988. Crematia, good evening and welcome to Channel News.
Hello, boys and ghouls. This is Crematia Mortem.
How did Crematia Mortem get her name?
Crematia got her name from Walt Bodine, the very famous Walt Bodine, the dean of Kansas City Broadcasting. She was searching for a name appropriate to her energy. And her friend, Roberta, came up with the name Crematia and said, that should be your first name. Walt Bodine gave her her last name, Mortem. And for a while she was married, but she was a hyphenate, Crematia Post-Mortem. But I just kept my married name for simplicity's sake, you know.
If you don't mind, could you give us a brief history of Creature Feature?
I don't know that a brief history is possible because there was so much packed into those 9 years. But the Creature Feature began on Kansas City 41 in 1982 and ran until January 1st of 1990. And I'm Crematia Mortem, and I was the hostess of the Creature Feature the whole time that it was on the air, which is a good thing because there wasn't anyone quite like me, you know. And the show was shown every Saturday night at 10:30. And then it got later and later, then 11 o'clock, and then at 12 o'clock, and then it just, poof, disappeared. So that was the history.
Can you tell our audience more about your background?
My background? Well, my mother's name was Desiree. I have a sister named Cremora. I have a weird cousin, Henry, and a manservant named Dweeb. And Rasputin helps me from time to time as well. That's the only background that's relevant. I have no other skills, so my family has to help me.
Could you tell our viewers about the opening sequence of your program?
Well, the opening sequence of the show changed from year to year. When I first started, of course, the camera just opened on me, standing next to this, I don't know if you can see it, this beautiful, well, this candelabra, which still, by the way, has the same candle wax on it that it had 17 and a half years ago. The camera opened on me standing in front of the candelabra, and that was it. Low budget, don't you know? As the years progressed, we changed the opening sequence of the show to include art from some of our viewers and, of course, some of the graphics people at Kansas City 41. We had to keep them employed, you know. But the art from the viewers opened the show year after year, and we would have a contest every year to see who could create the scariest painting that was used to open the Creature Feature.
Just out of curiosity, are there any unusual behind-the-scenes stories you'd like to tell us?
Well, when the creature feature came to an end, you know, every week I would step out of my coffin and say, "Good evening, boys and ghouls, it's time for another bad movie." Well, when the show was over, that coffin stayed in the KSHB studios for quite some time. They became an NBC affiliate, and Tom Brokaw came in to debut the station as an NBC station in Kansas City. And I wonder if he ever knew that while he was doing the nightly news, right there from Kansas City, there was a coffin behind the news set. He probably didn't know. I wonder what he would have thought if he did.
Did you feature any guests on your program?
I do remember one time we had a fellow who came on the show, and he had designed a giant monster costume made out of paper mache, and he got inside it on stilts. And we had some beautiful music playing, and I was supposed to look across the crowded room and see him and fall in love, and he was supposed to look at me and fall in love, and the music swelled, and I went, "Oh, my love, I've waited for you forever." And he looked at me and went, and began to walk across the set with these big clumping shoes of his. And he tripped on the rug, and all 8 feet of him fell like a tree. And you could hear it creaking as he fell over, and boom, he landed on the floor, and a big pile of dust went up. And from inside this giant paper mache thing, I heard, "Can you get me out of here?" It was very funny, although I didn't laugh at the time, and he was fine.
Are there any remaining early episodes of your program?
No. Well, there is some archival footage available, and I'm trying to compile that and make that available to viewers. But we were too cheap to record our shows and keep them every week. We would tape over the last week's show. So we didn't start archiving the shows until the very end of the creature feature, when we had 7 or 8 years under our belt. Every week in the beginning of the show, we would tape over what we had done last week. So there's really no record that I ever existed at all. Pity that.
Have you considered returning to television?
I'd love to come back. Ooh.
Are there any plans in the works now?
I've been talking with people. Unfortunately, the people haven't been listening all that much, but there have been some conversations about bringing Crematia and the Creature Feature back to Kansas City television. Stay tuned to this station for further details.
Thank you for visiting with us this evening, Crematia, and we hope that you're able to return to television again soon.
Ta-ta!
And now, back to the Basement Sublet of Horror.
One of the first horror host shows in the nation was Wichita's Nightmare. Nightmare ran from 1958 on and off, clear up into the 90s. The show featured the host and Rodney. The host was played by Tom Leahy. We now take you to an interview with Tom Leahy that was shot in 1986.
How many of you remember this from way back when? Well, an awful lot of us did back in 58 and 59 and again in 69 to 71 when Tom Leahy used to introduce the old Nightmare show. Only we didn't appreciate what a new thing we were watching. Vampira had been a costumed hostess all by herself in L.A. starting in 54. And Roland had become successful in Philadelphia and then famous as Zachary in New York, hosting and co-writing, and had an off-screen co-star. But Wichita's Tom Leahy was the first one who did it all, hosting and writing original scripts unrelated to the evening's movies, designing and painting the set, and creating the makeup design for both himself and his on-screen co-star Rodney, all without the benefit of ever having seen another host.
John Froom. John Froom came up with it. They had bought the old shock package, which came out at that time, and John came to me and asked, did I want to do it? Because he knew I was kind of way out at that time, anyway. A fired sort of cat, and asked me if I wanted to do it. I said, sure, I'd be glad to do it. And then we talked it and kicked it around and thought about a Laurel and Hardy concept. You know, I have a foil, a Goonie guy, and Lee Parsons was a stagehand at Cake at that time, and John thought of the name Rodney. And so we, he asked Lee. Lee was really excited about doing it, so we had a pretty good meld there, you know, and it went real well for about 2.5 years. When was it? I'd say 1954, 55 maybe. I don't know, really, honestly. It was way back there, 30 years ago at least. Well, yeah, we parodied modern society as much as anything, you know, much like the Addams Family in that the abnormal was the normal, you know, that sort of thing. But no, we didn't do anything about the films. The makeup and costumes I designed. John, the original set was designed by John and, you know, the stage crew there that built the thing. But I did the makeup and conceived of the makeup. Rodney took about 30 minutes, and mine about 32. The original Cake Nightmare, Bill Sykes, who is now program director at KSN, he and I worked together on the thing. Really, more or less, you know, we kicked it around is what we did. That was from the old shock package. They had that in the on the brochure that came, you know, and so we just had shot it, made photographs of it, and then burned it. Primitive, huh? You know, now you wouldn't do it this way. I think they sprayed lighter fluid on the back of the picture, lit it, and moved away from it, yeah. Just about one dry run is what we'd do. Mm-hmm. Because in those days, no videotape. You know, so whatever we did, that was it, and it went out. And just about one dry run, but we did very well, because we had a lot of visual effects that carried out. We didn't have chroma key in those days. So if you were going to, I know one instance we had where I had little nephew Claude come to visit, and little nephew Claude was supposed to be about 7 or 8 years old, and little nephew Claude was about 15 feet tall. He was a giant. I don't know if you recall it. So what we had to do, keep little nephew Claude on one side of the set, but we miniaturized that whole section of the set, and you know, and in proportion, and then blacked that part of the screen out, supered that in there where he played while we played in our section over here, in order to get the giantism. We got letters all the time, fan letters and things like that, but, and we had some pictures done, you know, handouts, and answer the letter and usually enclose a picture. But not as such. You don't understand, it was kind of like a throwaway thing. It filled a void on the programming from 10:30 to midnight or midnight to 1:30 or whatever they wanted to do. It was never what I call a premiere type presentation of that station, because that was about the beginning of the news wars, you know, and that's where all their interest was trying to get number one news here in the market. And no, we had seen none, because it was just getting off the ground. They tailored it around that shock package. That played all over the United States. So I think it was about the same time. They would almost be together, I would think. I think it was down in Philadelphia or something that was doing this story. Yeah. But I don't know. No, I never seen it. I don't know of any, except the gal in L.A., you know.
Elvira.
Didn't she come from Wichita, lived here one time or something like that? And that's, she does it for a campy thing. You know, it's kind of cute, what I've seen of it. We had two firecracker stands, Lee and I did, and we got in that makeup every night and raced from one stand to the other to make personal appearances. But the worst personal appearance I ever had was some skating rink. We went to a skating rink down south here someplace, and they wanted us on skates. Well, me on skates is next to a disaster. Oh, it was awful. And, you know, it was just terrible. Thank God it was only for an hour. Now, we had my girlfriend, my intended, Cynthia, We said nothing but blood and fell over in our mashed potatoes when we had a banquet. We had baby doll Glutkin, we had Agnes the abominable showgirl. We had, Infernal Residue Man was Lamont P. Treadwell, who we disposed of nicely. Well, at that time, Bill Sykes had moved over as program director for KSN. And he and I, well, we've been friends for a long time. So we were kicking around and said, well, Bill, what do we do? Hey, let's do Nightmare. We had a film package then. We were running on Saturday nights. No Saturday Night Live, of course. And there were some films in it, you know, that we could lift out. So he thought it'd be a kick. So it just so happened we had a cameraman by the name of Jim Herring who wanted to act and did a tremendous job, as you well know, just really great as Rodney. And they were about the same proportion as Lee was, you know, big man, muscular guy. And so we kicked it off. Wild man? I don't know, but he was a wild man. Could be me. What you saw is what you get, said with Jim, because he was a wild guy. Real a nice guy. Real wild, though, crazy guy. It lasted about 1971. So when did this start? In 68, 69, I guess, wasn't it? So it lasted about 3 years. I don't know. I don't know whether I want to go through that again. You know, I've got a whole bunch of scripts. I've got about 52 scripts that I've kept. And I'm not really a guy to keep memorabilia, but I don't know why I kept them, but I kept them. Just, I guess, to get them out once in a while, read them or something. It's hard to say. It's really hard to say. If they wanted to, I suppose, we would have search for Rodney or something like that and maybe have it on.
But we didn't realize back then what a remarkable thing the Leahy intros were, and so what you're about to see is the only surviving intact Nightmare intro with Tom Leahy as the host and Lee Parsons as Rodney, from near as we can figure out, 1959.
Good evening. The persistent monsoon that moans in the night, its breath a searing flame from the bowels of the underworld, carries on its breast an urgent plea from the quintillions of lost souls that roam the shadow world of that dark dimension. And this message vibrates serpentine-like up a royal across desolate wastelands, through the oily waters of the amphibian-infested swamps, over the crest of the ice-capped peaks, and down to the blasted hearth to shriek in our attentive audio receptacles that the hour for Nightmare is once again at hand. And what a succulent morsel of good fortune that we were ever at the ready for such a thing, video thieves. For a real blood icer, bone brittler, the cinema is about to flicker to life on your television screens. It is called The Frozen Ghost. And guess who stars in it? Morris? No. Baylor? No. But I'll give you a little hint. If a thing is frozen, it is bound to be stiff. Now, who is the stiffest actor in the universe? Huh? Right! Lon Chaney Jr., the most horrible horror thespian ever to don grease paint of unearthly hue and plastics of unnatural born. By the warlocks of Waxahachie, what are you doing, Rodney? What? You rude roustabout. Rodney, turn that blasted thing down. You hear me? What is this? Rodney, have you capitulated to the adolescent philosophy of rebellion without cause? Have you? Oh.
Well, it serves you well enough, Rodney. You're getting so bluff and show-offish about everything. Now you just plop your young flanks down on that chair a minute, fresh sprig. It's time you and I had a monster-to-monster talk. Straight from the shoulder, so to speak. Anatomically, that is.
Good evening. I've been looking forward to our little tete-a-tete all week long. And Rodney and I are all in a tizz over our feature tonight. Aren't we, Rodney? Rodney! Gone. I've had him in my hair all week long. And any other night, he's in my hair all the time. Rodney! Oh, there you are. Just when I need you most, Rodney. You're always out hanging around someplace else. Come on down here, Rodney, and bring the book of our patrons with you. As I was saying, Rodney and I are all a twit over our feature tonight. He's a good boy. Simple, but good.
Turn now to the Basement Sublet of Horror.
Sometimes things just go wrong on programs. The Basement Sublet of Horror has lots of problems. As a matter of fact, it's just been plagued by them. We now take you to a special treat. Tonight we are showing the outtakes from the Basement Sublet of Horror.
Hello, Gunther Detman here. Thank you for watching the Basement Sublet of Horror. I, your host, Gunther Detman, will return next week with another awful show. Let me get the phone. Why bother?
Let's try it again with the correct glasses on. There we go.
Do you hear that? Sublet of Horror. I am your host, Jonathan Denman, and I'd like to thank you for tuning in tonight. Hello, Gunther Detman here. We'll be back in a moment with the Basement Sublet of Horror. Ah.
I'm your host, Gunther Dedman, and I hit the mic. Okay. Yeah, that's the other thing. You know, like, I'm really bad about that. So that's why you see so many edits, too, is because I'm always hitting the mic.
But it works well. The edits work. They seem intentional. So
I figure if MTV can do it, what the hell? That's gooey. It's yucky. Let's turn it this way. It's even gooier this way. Let's top that puppy off. La 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 la. Oh, oh. Special effects. My landlord, clean your apartment up. It's too much of a mess. I'm going to kick you out. Well, oh, hello.
That was the one that made you laugh.
Oh, it's fine. I can trim it.
Okay.
I can trim it. Back with you again with another terrible film. This week I've got a topper for you. An absolutely armpit of a movie, and that won't work.
What? Armpit? I like it.
Really?
Yeah. Absolute armpit of a movie, definitely.
Okay. Hello. What the hell am I doing here? I have no idea. It's a snoozer. It's Killers from Space. Directed in 1954. I think I'll start over. You wanted another take. Well, after that flashback, you sure get thirsty, so... Yes, well, you can fill in the blank for me there, because I just blanked out. But I got a good half, front half, anyway. There we go. I'll have to hold them in place. Maybe
it's
I'll get...
It's pretty funny, though, if you just hold them like that.
Yes. Anyway, you'll have to line it up with me. I cannot see, so...
It's good. Let me just move it up a little bit. Okay.
So, during the House on Haunted Hill, what he did, and I've heard there's two different ways. One way, when the ghost or the skeleton comes out of the vat of lava. A double for the Emperor. Now there's two of those fat bastards. I don't want to do that, though. But let's go. lost my brain. We'll be back next week with another awful film for you on the Basement Sublet of Horror. I think that was good. That's fun.
All right, I'm rolling.
Well, let me get set up here.
Well, I didn't want to miss you pulling it all.
Oh, okay. And I don't know if the mic will work on this either, so you'll have to tell me.
It sounded pretty good.
All right. Maybe I'll move it up a little bit. How's the sound on that?
It's fine. It's a little muffled, but it should be.
Okay. Ah, yes, Gunther Dedman. I'm ready for the next part of our film. Hello, my friends, and welcome again to the Basement Sublet of Phone Calls. Hello? I'm returning to you tonight with The Last Man on Earth, starring Vincent Price, directed by Umberto Rigoni, or something like that. I don't know. It's some kind of macaroni. I can't see that, though.
What, we could say macaroni?
Some kind of macaroni name. Hello, my friends, and welcome to the Basement Sublet of Horror. I'm your host... Oh, Gunther Dedman, sorry. I was thinking of the director's name, not mine. Oh, hello, my friends, and welcome to the Basement Sublet of Horror. I'm your host, Gunther Dedman, back with you again for another episode of the show I just named. Ah, oh, hello, my friends, and welcome to the Basement Sublet of Horror. Tonight, Carnival of Souls, the 1954
of Horror.
Clean out the films. Yes, we'll put them right over here. Well, that should do. it seems like that would fall, doesn't it?
You would think.
Thank you for watching our Channel News special edition on Horror Host. We'd like to send special thanks to Crematia Mortem. Thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to allow us an interview. It was really a special moment for our show. I'm Richard Wayne. Thanks again for watching. Good evening.
Yes, Gunther, here we are at the Feast of Horrors convention. I'm sitting here waiting for people to arrive.